Happy Victoria Day, everybody. Jose Tabuada alongside Norv Cabrera. Tis another week to talk about what's going on in the world of baseball. How are you doing, Norv?
Pretty good. And always exciting this season so far. And looking forward to more.
Yeah, so I'm liking this tradition of what I started here of like talking about where are we in the standings? Where are we in the race as we get closer and closer to October? I mean, we still got a ways to go, but it doesn't hurt to see if you're listening to this at any random point, just to know where the team stands. So in the American League East, the Red Sox and those pesky Rays are tied for first in the AL East with the Yankees a game behind as the Blue Jays have tanked in the last week. Screw the Rays. Can't wait to go to Buffalo. In the AL Central, the White Sox have a lead, a game and a half ahead of the Cleveland Indians. And really quickly, obviously, we're not going to talk about this today, but the hilarity on swinging on 3-0 pitches and Tony La Russa being Tony La Russa. Not much else to say other than good God almighty. Once again, here we are. I can't believe it took us nearly 2 months to have the conversation about the unwritten rules of baseball. Stupid, but do you have any thoughts on that really quick before I continue?
Well, you know what? It's always been an unwritten rule, and it's also a very baffling rule.
Yeah.
The 3-0 count that when you swing at it, I mean, you know, you're up there trying to just hit whatever you can. And when it comes to 3-0, and all of a sudden, like, it's supposed to be a stop for you to not hit. An old school manager type mentality, but you know what? It's completely up to you if you want to swing on it.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, I know they were up big on the Twins, and I know it was a position player pitching, La Tortuga, the Turtle, William Astudillo, but hey, like, if you see a good pitch, I mean, I do it in MLB The Show, it's the 3-0 pitch, just the hitter's count. If you see a good pitch, no matter what the score is, swing, dude, pad your stats. It's,
absolutely.
It's all good. So props to Mercedes on that. Props to Tim Beckham and the rest of the team for sticking up for him, and Tony La Russa. I don't know what else to say, but that's just a quick thoughts on that, because we do have two bigger topics that we'll share in a bit, but I think it had to be emphasized, like, God damn it. Meanwhile, over in the American League West, the Athletics are a game and a half ahead of the Houston Astros. Over to the National League in the East, the Mets are a game and a half ahead of the Braves and the Phillies as that race is slowly heating up. I mean, Miami is in fourth, but they're only two games behind. The Nationals only 2.5 games behind. So that's a pretty tight race in the NL East so far. A lot of competition there. In the Central, I can't say the same for that, as the Cardinals are 3 games ahead of the Cubs, Milwaukee 3.5 behind, you know, and Cincinnati and Pittsburgh, God bless their souls for participating. And finally, in the National League West, the other fun little competitive division that we have there, the Padres only a game ahead of the Dodgers, 2 games ahead of the Giants. That little trio there has been interesting so far. I know the Giants and the Dodgers have had their rivalry renewed this past week at the time of recording. That's been entertaining. And of course, Slam Diego has returned with a couple of grand slams that we've seen from the Padres this past weekend. So that's where we stand. And of course, as my bias self will always say, go Blue Jays. And as Norb's bias self would say, go Diamondbacks. So,
well, yeah, I mean, they're faltering right now.
I know. They are actually, oh my goodness, I just realized they're 12.5 games behind the Padres. Oh, Lord.
Yeah.
That's I don't want to remind you of that, except that they're 12.5 games behind the Padres
rough
there.
Road that they've had as of late.
Yeah, they're 1-9 in the last 10. That's not pretty. I don't want to torture you any further, because I can't talk because of the way that the Blue Jays bullpen has completely collapsed against the Red Sox and the Rays. So I feel your pain. Anyways, our two topics for today. One of them is a topic that we spoke about a couple weeks back, but we need to go further in depth, because at the time when we announced this topic, we were going, okay, that's just a weird coincidence. And now all of a sudden there are 6 of them. And by 6 of them, I mean 6 no-hitters before the end of May. So we're going to be talking about the no-hitter situation and what's going on in MLB. And of course, the Athletics made headlines when they said, when they announced that there may not be a new stadium and they're considering relocation. And so everybody's again going crazy. And if you're an Oakland sports fan, I cannot imagine how miserable you must have felt with that news. But more on that later. Let's talk about our first biggest topic, Norb, and that's the no-hitter. 6 no-hitters now. And ironically enough, out of those 6 no-hitters, there are only 3 teams were victims of those no-hitters. Each of them got 2. The Rangers, the Mariners, and the Indians. 2 of them each. Unreal. That has never happened in MLB history.
Unbelievable. Of all the teams, there has to be three teams that has been victimized twice.
In that whole thing. You would think that when you hear the term six no hitters, that it'd be different teams, and no, it's mind boggling. Corey Kluber from the Yankees, the latest to get the no hitter, a couple weeks back from the time last week from the time of recording, and then the night beforehand, Spencer Turnbull from the Tigers, back to back nights with no hitters too. I mean, that's even crazier. So, obviously, the biggest question is, how did they do it, and what's going on? So, Norb, you have some thoughts on the two latest no-hitters from Turnbull and Kluber. So, go ahead. What do you got for us when it comes to this discussion?
Well, leading up to this no-hitter games for Turnbull and Kluber, let's just start off with Spencer Turnbull. Turnbull and Kluber were in the month of May. Turnbull was actually pitching badly leading up to his no-hitter. Kluber was pitching exceptional, actually, leading up to his no-hitter. Turnbull, his first two starts in May versus the Yankees and the Red Sox were pretty uneventful. He gave up four runs each in those games, losing to the Yankees and a no-decision versus the Red Sox. And then he turned things around May 13th versus the Royals, seven strikeouts in six and a third innings, picking up the victory. And then, of course, leading up from that game to his no-hitter versus the Mariners, 5 days later, striking out nine batters and walking two. Spencer Turnbull has been he's got a bull in his name, but he's been one of the workhorses in the Tigers rotation. He's really coming into his own for that team, even though that they're one of the bottom teams in the AL Central. Turnbull has been the light and the highlight of that pitching rotation for the Tigers, for that young team. Corey Kluber, on the other hand, looking like the days of old. It's unbelievable. Trying to turn his career around this year after a disastrous 2020 season with the Rangers, when they acquired him, where he suffered a season-ending injury, as I recall, pitching one inning in his very first game. Kluber had a terrific May, actually. Three wins in his last four starts in the month, including, of course, the no-hitter versus Texas, where he felt like the days of old, striking out nine and only walking one batter. And just a little over 100 pitches. Seemingly the Cy Young Corey Kluber that we watched years past.
And of course, one of the bigger topics when it came to the Mariners itself was just how bad of a team that they're hitting. They're literally last. They're literally last at the time of this recording. They are batting as a team 198. 198. That is not good. And second last, the Indians at 213. The Rangers sit 14th with 236. But they just cannot find the ball. I was reading a couple articles here. CBS's Matt Snyder pointed out that Turnbull had his stuff. Turnbull 100% had his stuff. He threw 37 slider. His slider averaged 84.4 miles an hour. His fastballs average 93. I mean, that's technically not even that strong. His sinker is averaging 94. His sinkers. And then his changeups at 87. And then curveballs averaging at 78. So he mixed his pitches. He got what he got the job done as to what he needed to do. But of course, obviously, again, now the question of six no-hitters in such a small span of time. Apparently, we are on average for 23 no-hitters. 23. The modern day record is seven. I mean, I believe that was in 2015-ish or 18 something. There's always something in the 1800s that's just ridiculous. There's always, like I said in the last episode, there's always that stupid stat from the 1800s that makes you go, "What the hell?" I mean, and technically we have seven no hitters too because of Madison Bumgarner's no-hitter in the doubleheader, but because it's only seven innings now in a doubleheader, they're not going to count it, which is stupid because he no-hit them. But anyways, it is what it is. So the question now is, what is going on, and is there something fishy? One of the points I wanted to make, there was an anonymous National League team. This is from the reported by from Ken Rosenthal of The Athletic, saying that a National League club passed around a rookie's first hit ball, and it was extremely sticky hours after the game. That it's just extremely, extremely sticky, that it took a while to get the glue off and whatnot. So, of course, they were asking, what is going on? Is this, do you think that there's a new substance out there? Or maybe is it just good old pine tar again that pitchers have been cleverly hiding better to get the job done?
I mean, who really knows? Some people are also saying that the seams seem to be a different feeling. The past couple of years, they've Major League Baseball has been eyeing on like so many juice balls, as they would call it, just because there's just a lot of home runs that have been hit the past few seasons, and it seems like the ball is pretty different this year with the seams or with the feel of the ball or with the leather. But who knows? I mean, it's just one of those things. It could be superstition. Who knows? But it really does feel like the year of the pitcher this year. This season definitely has become the pitcher's year with these no hitters and with these fantastic, majestic games that these starting pitchers are displaying. And it also goes, even though that there's a lot of rumors behind the baseball or how these balls are managed or how the games are managed, it also goes to show you that even this day and age in baseball, that the starting pitcher can go far in a ball game, they can go deep, and they can even finish the game. They finish what they started. It is an old school tradition that the starting pitcher, finishes what they started. I mean, we've seen Hall of Famers like Jack Morris and Nolan Ryan and Randy Johnson, even the pitchers of the 1920s like Walter Johnson, Christy Mathewson. They pitched solidly in their careers. They finished what they started, and heck, they even pitched like the 2 days after with hardly any rest. So we're really seeing, this spike of like pitching consistency. And it's something that the new school managers should be learning, that if your pitcher is dealing and they feel good about it, you leave them in the game until they say uncle, until they cry uncle, so to speak. And it's something really nice happening in baseball right now. And it seems to me that we are on pace to break the record for most no hitters in a season, and I kind of like it. It's pretty good.
We had 21 complete games so far this year across MLB, and you bring up managers trusting their starting pitching, but of course when you're the opposition, you may have a different input, and a lot of players, some of the likes of Clayton Kershaw, I think he's an elite pitcher. I think he's a pitcher from the Dodgers. I can't confirm. Clayton Kershaw are on record saying that they don't think it's good for the game. Alex Cora is out there saying it's not good. Braves manager Brian Snitker was saying, "Good God, when have we ever seen six no hitters? It's hard to get a hit. It's hard to get a hit." And Alex Cora saying there's too many right now. Like I said, Clayton Kershaw saying that it's not good. And even Texas Rangers manager Chris Woodward is saying that he thinks that the reason why there are more no-hitters today is just because of the technology that is available to these players. I mean, obviously, of course, every broadcast we see some like Statcast, when it comes to even just batting alone, obviously there's technology like that, like websites like FanGraphs that dig into the analytics of pitching, and so again, like it kind of makes you wonder like why. See, I like it too. I'm a huge fan of it. It's tough because sometimes, there's like people complain that there's not enough defense and they want to see more pitching. And then if it's the other way around, then they complain, oh my God, there's not enough offense. What the heck? Right. I mean, like for me personally, I appreciate a no hitter. I think it is extremely difficult to pull one off. I mean, I can't even do it in a video game on rookie mode. That's how tough it is, right? But I appreciate that there are, like, these pitchers are going out there making this happen, right? And see, I know people are saying that is a no-hitter watered down, but to me, I'm also saying, well, none of these are perfect games, which I think with the amount of no-hitters that are happening, I think that the perfect game has now become even more elite and more, I can't think of the word anymore. More elite and I had a word in my mind, I can't think of it, but they're special. Yeah. I think the Orioles pitcher, I forgot his name. He was John about, Beans was, thank you.
One of the pitchers that pitched the no hitter.
Thank
year.
You. He was a dropped third strike away from a perfect game. And obviously, of course, you know, people were saying that the drop third strike rule is stupid, but I'm pretty sure they wouldn't have brought it up if it wasn't in that situation, because it happens all the time. But imagine if you got the perfect game. That would have been the 24th in history. We haven't seen a perfect game since King Felix Hernandez on the Mariners against the White Sox. And to me, yes, there are a lot of no-hitters, and yes, I kind of want to see the Blue Jays get 1-2 in a biased way, but the day we see a perfect game again, and I hope there is one, I guarantee you that pitcher is going to be put on a pedestal, and rightfully so, because of how many no-hitters are happening. I want to see it, and I appreciate good defense. Norby had more to add on to that.
I think it's entirely possible still. You know, these pitchers are really dealing. They're feeling good about their repertoire, and they're really, in a good vibe when they're up there in the mound. With the example of Corey Kluber, his pitch count was over a little over 100 pitches. I mean, that goes to show you that, you know, you're mixing your pitches, you're painting the corners in the strike zone, and you're getting guys out. I mean, the hitters, I mean, like there's some guys that are up there that are extremely impatient hitters trying to swing for the fence left or right. And you got the other guys out there just want to get hit from the first pitch that they see. I mean, like the concentration and the focus on these batters is questionable sometimes. Like when you're up there, you're always, your rule of thumb is always to see pitches. Like you want to see pitches. You don't want to be impatient out there. I mean, you want to get your at bat over with one hit. I mean, that's completely up to you. But you know what? When you're in a situation where you want to get on base, you want to spray the corners all around the field. Like you just want to show how good you are as a hitter, then don't hit the first pitch that you see and you fly out or you ground out or anything like that. You want to go out there and see pitches. Like let the pitcher throw you some, you know. But if you can't come in contact with one, then that means that the pitcher is just painting the corners on you and you're getting out there. I mean, it's just a time-honored tradition to always go out there and see pitches. Don't be impatient. Don't be a first pitch hitter just because like you want to hit one from on the fence. You know, it's just a lesson that those hitters got to learn.
And to back up your point, Sports Illustrated had a roundtable, and one of the people that part of the roundtable was MLB Network's Tom Verducci, who laid out some stats. And what he said is just essential to what you just said in terms of like batters swinging or not seeing their pitches. The major league batting average this year is at an all-time low at .234, all-time low. And then teams are averaging only 7.8 hits per game. And only in the year 1908, which is the dead ball era, which is considered the dead ball era in baseball, saw fewer hits per game, which is 7.75, 9 strikeouts, roughly 33 at-bats per game, which kind of means that only 24 of them, only 24 balls are in play, which again brings up your point. A lot of first pitch swinging, a lot of like, I need the long ball. And I mean, everybody knows I'm a Jays fan, and seeing what happened this past weekend, especially it was a crucial game when they went to extras a couple nights ago against the Rays. And you're like, they're just swinging for the fences, or they're not playing a small ball. And I'm like, guys, you need to concentrate here. Like, what are we doing? And of course, it cost them the win as the Rays are now on a nine game winning streak. But like I said, for me personally, to wrap this up, because we do got to move on to the next topic. I appreciate no hitters. I do think they're fascinating. I mean, like, I think I'm on record with Fair Fall saying that, like, if there's one thing I've always wanted to do, it's to be a pitcher, just because I love the science behind it, like the grips on the ball and the movement and the wrist position. That fascinates the heck out of me. I tried pitching a few times with some buddies. Like, I know how to hold a four seam fastball. I know how to hold a curveball. I know how to hold a changeup. Does it mean I can execute each of those pitches? No. But it's fun. I appreciate it. And I just, like, whether we see an insane amount of no hitters, well, it's still yet to come, because, you know, all of a sudden it could just suddenly not happen. But I hope that it is at least one of them is a perfect game, because I think that will be absolutely, as I said before, absolutely special if it does happen. But let's move on. To a bigger topic, and we're going to talk about the Oakland Athletics. What's been reported in the last week or so, that they may be on the move. They may be on the move, and like I said at the start of this pod, if you're an Oakland sports fan, you already lost the Raiders to Las Vegas, and I know Oakland and the Athletics are very loved in Oakland. Of course, who can forget their three-peat in the '80s. Going into the '90s, they do have like a storied franchise, and now they're at risk of being relocated because of stadium issues. There's talks. There's like a lot of conflict, a lot of disputes about whether to build a brand new ballpark. I believe it was I can't remember who said it. I think it was the team that's saying that that like there's no plans for it. There's no support for a new stadium, which is again frustrating as heck. Because yes, that stadium that they're right now, Rickey Henderson Field, is atrocious. It's really bad. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of looking at it. I hate the foul territory. I hate like how deep it is. It just irks me. It irks me. I want them to have a new stadium. And they may not get it. And of course, and recently they also said that the Athletics president, Dave Cavall, has said that apparently representatives from six cities have contacted him. Now, while we don't know who the six cities are, there was a report that one of them most likely may be Las Vegas, which at this point I feel like if you're an Oakland sports fan, you're ready to set the city on fire. Athletic officials have stated that they want to explore Las Vegas as a relocation, which is really interesting. And then in the past, Baseball Commissioner Rob Manfred is saying that cities such as Charlotte, Nashville, Portland, Montreal, and Vancouver have been interested in being relocated. So, Norb, let's start with you, because I have a lot to say on this. Norb, let's start with you with your thoughts on this whole idea of, like, the team being relocated.
Well, you know, I may not be an Oakland Athletics fan, but I'm a diehard baseball fan, and yeah, it breaks my heart that, you know, a storied franchise that has moved, it's no stranger to moving in the past. I mean, it started off as the Philadelphia Athletics, and then they moved to Kansas City, and then they moved to Oakland. I mean, they're no strangers of relocating, but it really breaks my heart that, you know, a storied franchise like the Oakland Athletics, who's won multiple World Series, the 1970s was like the grand old time for them. Three-peating in 72, 73, and 74. They had legendary players like Reggie Jackson. You know, they've had so many, you know, Hall of Fame, worthy, competitors, you know, Dave Stewart, Mark McGwire, Carney Lansford, Rickey Henderson, Tony La Russa's, you know, their former manager. It really breaks my heart. And it's such a shame. It's a total shame that the city of Oakland is doing this to the team. I mean, this franchise has put a lot of entertainment for their fans. You know, when they won that 20-game winning streak back in 2002, the city came together to watch this team. I mean, what more that the team has to do? What more successes that the team has to display in order to please the city of Oakland to, you know, lobby for a new ballpark? I mean, you know, there's a lot of fan base in Oakland. and for the city, just to, you know, dump them and have them relocate to another town. It's just unbelievable. It's a shame, and it should be they should be condemned. Unfortunately, you know, pardon my French there. It is very damning that the city is just doing this to them. I mean, the A's are a very exciting franchise, and you know, to relocate to another city. You know, what are the you know, the Oakland A's fans going to do? Like, they're going to travel to Las Vegas or to wherever they go, you know, for games. And it's going to cost them a lot more money to travel. I mean, they want a new stadium. They want their team to stay in the city, and it's a shame that the city of Oakland is doing this to them. I mean, there's just a lot of suitors out there that are interested, and I'm pleased that Montreal is in the mix there. But I would not be surprised, because Las Vegas is a very, you know, a giant sports city as of late now. I mean,
yeah, I was going to say now it is. Yeah. Yeah, it's a growing city in terms of sports wise. Yeah.
Golden Knights, and they got the Raiders now, and they're going to put their money down for the Oakland A's to relocate there in a heartbeat. And you know, they are the front runners. They've always been interested in moving the A's to Allegiant Stadium, as I understand, because that's a giant, big stadium now.
Is it Allegiant Stadium they're considering?
Well, I'm not too sure about that, but
That would suck.
The Raiders play, as I understand.
No, that's where they play. But I mean, imagine relocating to a city just to have the same problem that you had in Oakland. How many football fans hated to see the baseball diamond on the field for games? Vice versa. How many times have baseball fans been pissed off to see yard lines on the field? It's that I would be. I mean, I hated the Athletics playing like in October or in September because of the Raiders. Like I hated, like, it's frustrating. And heck, I mean, I like, biasedly, I would prefer it to be baseball, but it was just so annoying and so unsettling. Like, you know, you're running on grass all of a sudden, for football players especially, with the risk of injury, you're running on grass and all of a sudden there's the dirt. Oh, you're running past the 50 yard line, second base, touchdown. Yeah. It's frustrating. That I would hope not. I want to presume that they would want to build a new stadium. That's what I would do if Vegas all of a sudden has all this money, or whoever the right owners are.
Yeah, well, if you're concerned with the timing, like, you know, Major League Baseball right now has given the city of Oakland an ultimatum to have the Oakland A's relocate. But imagine, like, Las Vegas takes the win there and moves the team to Las Vegas. I mean, like, the timing factor has to be considered for building a new stadium there. But maybe the original plan would be for Oakland to play in Allegiant Stadium and perhaps move on to a newer ballpark. That's what the Rockies did in 1993 when they came into the league. They played at Mile High Stadium, where the Broncos played for a long time.
They still do.
Rockies played there for a little bit, and then in 1997, according to my understanding, they moved to Coors Field. So quite possibly, I mean, you gotta worry about the timing factor there. I mean, if Oakland, you know, potentially moves in a couple of years, they gotta get the stadium ready by then if they want to start building now in Las Vegas. If Las Vegas does win the bid to move the Oakland A's.
And I mean, of course, it wouldn't be the first baseball football situation. I mean, yeah, the Marlins, they used to play where the Miami Dolphins play now before, until they built their new stadium. Of course, the Blue Jays started off at Exhibition Stadium, which is a CFL field for the Toronto Argonauts before the Sky Dome came around in the 80s. I'm going to end on a controversial point, a little bit of a controversial point. I mean, I'm seeing these potential cities. I'm really hoping it's not Montreal. I'm going to go out of my way and say I hope it's Montreal, selfishly, because I've grown to love the idea of the Blue Jays being Canada's only team. That is exciting. But aside from that, that's not even like my really biggest point. My biggest point is Olympic Stadium is atrocious. It's awful. I mean, one of the biggest reasons why the Expos moved to Washington and became the Nationals was because of the lack of funding, bankruptcy, and the lack of a new stadium. And Olympic Stadium is just so bad. Why the hell would you go back to Montreal and suffer with that again? I mean, there has been no plans whatsoever for a new stadium. Even when, I mean, it was nice when the Blue Jays ended their spring training there in the last few years. Okay, great. But I mean, like, and obviously everybody's going to go back for the nostalgia, and rightfully so, right? It's baseball again at Olympic Stadium in Montreal. How is that going to be? I mean, everybody seems to forget that those final brutal years in Montreal, the lack of fan attendance, the revenue dropping more and more and more. It's like, do you want to go back to that? Like, do you want to, like, unless there was a plan for a brand new stadium, then I'm all for it. Sure. Bring back the Expos. Let's shut up the people on Twitter that refuse to call the Washington Nationals the Washington Nationals and say, so-and-so is playing, the Blue Jays are playing the Expos today in Washington. I'm like, what? Come on, guys. Like, it's over. Like, it's nearly 20 years, actually. It's been nearly 20 years since they're there. And no, the Montreal Expos did not win the World Series in 2019. The Washington Nationals won the World Series in 2019. That is my gripe. If there was a plan for Montreal to get a new stadium, do it. Do it. If there's not, don't touch it. Do not touch it. And don't you dare say you're going to go back to Olympic Stadium. Because I think if I lived in Montreal and I was a Quebecer, I would probably like punch a wall if I heard that we have to go back to Olympic Stadium for regular baseball. I know, believe me, I know the fans want Montreal back. And technically, as a baseball purist, I should be as well. And I think that for baseball in this country, I think it'd be great for a new generation to once again see a Toronto-Montreal rivalry in baseball, as we're currently watching once again a Montreal-Toronto rivalry in hockey in the NHL. It'd be great. It'd be healthy for competition, for rivalry, but you do not do it back in a stadium. If they relocate and say, okay, we're going to play in an Olympic Stadium, Lord have mercy. That's all I want to say here. Vancouver's not a bad city. Nashville would be interesting too, because I know obviously the other Predators there. Charlotte and Portland, I don't see as strong candidates, to be honest. And even Vancouver, I've been to Vancouver. I don't, what do we use? BC Place, I guess, as a baseball stadium. And like, I mean, I've been inside BC Place. It's not anything. It's a cool stadium. It's
the oldest Olympic stadium.
Exactly. It's a fine stadium. Like, I've been in there. I saw some CFL action. It was fun, but I don't see, I guess, yeah, probably. Montreal and Las Vegas would be the better options. But yeah, I mean, if you're going to do it, and again, I hope not, because I'm with you. I also condemn like the owners for like just completely like messing this all up. But I would do Las Vegas as well. But on that note, that is where we are going to end our pod for the day. Norb, thank you as always for having us continue. And we will see you guys at the next recording. Take care, everybody.